Hi, everyone, and welcome to another exciting episode of Classic Gamer 74. I'm your host, Anthony. Mumford.
Oh, sorry about that. Hi, everyone, this is Mumford.
And today we're going to be discussing games that were based on films. A majority of the games that we're going to be talking about in today's episode were from the Atari 2600.
That's right. This was the system in which many of the games that were based on films came from.
Exactly. You didn't have many of them from the other game systems, and if you did, they usually came on the Atari 2600 first.
Exactly.
Basing a video game on a movie was not a new concept by the mid-80s.
Exactly.
Now, what was new is that there were some video games that were based on films that really didn't seem like they had any business having a game tie-in.
Oh, yeah, you got a point there.
And by this time, 20th Century Fox, which is the game company that made several of the games in today's episode, started making games. They pretty much started making games for just about every film that they ever made, whether the film was good or whether the film had been successful. So before we get into some of the new games that we're going to discuss today, let's talk about some of the games we've discussed in previous episodes that were based on films. First, of course, has to be the Star Wars games. You had Return of the Jedi, the Death Star Battle, Star Wars, the arcade game, The Empire Strikes Back, Jedi Arena, and the unreleased prototype Ewok Adventure.
Yeah, I'll tell you, of any series of movies that just screamed, make a video game, it had to be Star Wars.
We also had Crawl, that was made into a game for the Atari 2600 and for the arcade. Halloween, and Texas Chainsaw Massacre. Both of these games are extremely rare, even back in the day, and are highly sought after by collectors.
Alien, this film and its many sequels were also made into games.
Flash Gordon, the prototype Planet of the Apes. I enjoyed this game so much I had a standalone episode dedicated to it.
And finally, Raiders of the Lost Ark. This game is considered by some to be one of the most difficult Atari games in history. Anthony also had a standalone episode about this game.
And now for today's trivia question. In a previous episode, the one about prototypes, I discussed a game that myself and several other people believed was actually a tie-in to the film Six Pack, the Kenny Rogers film. However, in recent months, it has come to light that it was actually based on another film. So, today's question is, what is the name of the film that this racing game was actually based on? You think you know the answer? Wait till the end and see if you're correct. And our first game for today is a prototype that is of the game The Alligator People, programmed by John Russell from 1983. All right, now even though the 1950s film was really, really bad, this is a perfect example of a game that is better than the movie it was based on. Now in this game, you play the role of Jane Marvin, who must save her husband and his friends who are turning into alligator people due to a failed medical treatment. Now Jane, who looks like a syringe, must shoot each person on the top and bottom of the screen with a special alligator antidote until they are cured. Okay, now the alligators aren't just going to let Jane wander about curing people unmolested, otherwise it wouldn't be much of a game. So Jane must avoid roving alligators and moving walls while collecting vials of antidote and serum.
Now the game itself is a lot of fun and it's quite challenging. There's actually three different varieties of the game on here. Now, unfortunately, this wasn't released. As we said, it's a prototype. Now, for reasons unknown, the game was not released. I suspect it had a lot to do with the video game crash of 83 and 84. There's an interesting story behind the game, as people believe the game was actually lost forever until it was found in 2002. So the game is readily available on the internet, so if you've never played it and you'd like to give it a try, by all means, give it a try and you'll really enjoy it.
Exactly, Mumford. You'll probably end up enjoying the game much more than that movie.
Next, from 1982, we have E.T. the Extraterrestrial, programmed by Howard Scott Warshaw, and graphics by Jerome Dumouriez. All right, now let me start off by saying that I did not think this game was as bad as everyone said it was. Personally, I enjoyed it when I was a kid. I played it quite a few times, beat the game, and although, to be honest with you, it did get quite annoying. I mean, there were just so many of those tar pits you keep falling in, and it would get frustrating after a while. But to be honest with you, I didn't think it was all that bad. Of course, the film itself is considered one of the greatest films of all time, and so therefore, it wouldn't be surprising at all that, you know, the video game adaption wouldn't live up to the hype, but that's just the beginning of the story. Right, all in all, this game was a big financial failure for Atari. They invested $25 million for the rights to make the game. They rushed it into production and got it out. And, it was just a big mess all around. But to be honest with you, I agree with you. It wasn't that bad of a game. Of course, you notice while we're playing, you just keep falling in them pits all the time. And the game probably could have been better had they been able to spend more time on it. And, of course, the object of the game is to get E.T. home. He's been left behind by a ship. You have to get pieces of a phone, call home, and, you know, that's pretty much it. Again, this is an example, kind of the opposite of what some of these other games were. You may have had a bad film and a really good game. Well, this particular game is based on a movie that everyone loved, and the game was a game that not everybody liked. So, but anyway, what is your opinion of E.T. the Extraterrestrial? Did you enjoy the game? Let me know about it in the comment section below. I'd really like to know what you have to say. Next, from 1983, we have Porky's, programmed by Randall Hyde. Now, what can I say about the film Porky's that hasn't already been said? It's a comedy film from the early 1980s. And the best way I can describe it is that it is a film that's kind of a rite of passage for young men and boys. That's probably about the best way to put it.
Yeah, I can't agree with you more on that one.
For those of you that happen to be one of the few people on this planet that have never seen the film Porky's, I won't give away too much of the plot here. I'll just give you a quick summary of the game. Now, in this game, you take on the role of Edward Pee-wee Morris, and you're trying to get to Porky's so that you can blow it up. Now, this first part of the game is one that frustrates people the most. You are trying to help build a bridge so that you can basically get out from the subterranean place that you're stuck in. Now, this next part of the game, you are trying to get some tools to help you blow it up. Now, be careful because you are actually right outside the girl's shower room, and if you look at the girl Wendy in the shower, you have to worry about Ms. Ballbreaker coming after you. And if she catches you, you got to start all over again. Next, you're trying to work your way across the street to get to Porky's, which is completely on the other side. If you get hit by a vehicle, you gotta go back to the subterranean area, avoid Porky, and do it again. And the final part, you're trying to climb this fence to get to Porky's so that you can blow it up. Overall, it's a great fun based on one of my all-time favorite films. Next, from 1982, we have Fantastic Voyage, programmed by David Lubar. Now, in this game, you and your submarine are to be injected into the bloodstream of a critically ill patient. Your mission is to blast your way through several phases of artery obstacles and destroy a life-threatening blood clot.
I really enjoyed this game, and I really liked the movie, too.
I think the reason you liked the movie so much is because Raquel Welch was in it. Am I right?
Yeah, I admit it.
And I have to agree with you, though. This is a really fun game. I'm not much for vertical scrolling shooter games, but I have to tell you, this game is quite fun and very challenging. But I have to agree, this is an example of a game that is just as great as the film it was based on. Of course, the film itself was nominated for multiple Academy Awards. There was a spin-off animated series, and it was actually based on a really cool book of the same name. So if you haven't seen the film Fantastic Voyage, I highly recommend it.
And if you haven't played this game, you are missing out on a real treat. While we're on the subject of sci-fi, let's talk about Tron. Tron from 1982 was one of the greatest sci-fi movies I think I've ever seen, when I was a kid and today as well. The movie had great characters, a great cast, awesome special effects. In other words, it was perfect for game adaptions. And with that in mind, yes, there were several video game tie-ins to the film. But for today, we're going to focus on just the ones for the Atari 2600. Later on, I will have an episode dedicated to all the game tie-ins to the movie Tron. First game is Adventures of Tron from 1982, published by M Network and programmed by Hal Finney. In this particular game, what you're trying to do is try to keep your character Tron alive. It's a platformer game. You're trying to collect these objects, score points, and above all, try to stay alive. Now you have the Master Control Program attackers coming after you, recognizers and grid bugs, and cannon firing tanks. Try to collect the objects and get out of there without getting killed. Now next up, also from 1982, you have Tron Deadly Discs. This was programmed by Brett Stutz and Jeff Ron. Alright, in this game you once again take on the role of Tron, and you are battling against these evil warriors. Now it's usually 3-1, and you have the saucers as the weapons, and you're trying to get them before they get you. I'll be honest with you, as much as I liked this game, I honestly like the Intellivision version better. Well, I have to agree, they're both pretty good. And yes, I actually had not played the Intellivision version until a few years ago, and I'll tell you, I have to agree with you on that one. In the spring of 1983, if you bought both of the games, you could get this really cool Tron-themed joystick. I've always wanted one of these things, so if you happen to have one, let me know about it, especially if you're willing to part with it. And from 1983, we have MASH, programmed by Frank Cohen and Doug Neubauer. MASH was a great film, and possibly even a greater television show. One of my personal favorites. I think this show is probably going to be in syndication for forever. How about you, Mumford? What'd you think?
Oh, I totally agree. I love the show. You know, I was in the war. Oh, you were in Korea? No, I was in the Revolutionary War.
Huh?
Never mind.
All right, now, in this game, you take on the role of Hawkeye Pierce, Chief Medical Surgeon of the 4077. What you're doing is you are rescuing these injured men from the battlefield, and then you are performing surgery. So, in this game, you've got to be careful and make sure you pick up as many of the men as you can and look out for the Koreans that are shooting at you. Now, in the surgery part, you're trying to get the shrapnel out, but make sure you don't touch the side like that or you kill the patient.
Kind of reminds you of that one game we used to play when I was a kid.
Oh, Operation?
Yeah, that's it.
Yeah, kind of, sort of. Yeah, but in a video game. And you're also competing against another doctor. Depending on who you talk to, you're either going against BJ Honeycutt, Trapper John McIntyre, or Frank Burns. And just like the TV show and the movie this was based on, MASH was a great video game. Also, 20th Century Fox really knew how to market their games, as back in the day, if you purchased this game for a few extra bucks, you could get a MASH t-shirt. So, if any of you were able to get that t-shirt, let me know about it in the comment section below. Alright, and next up from 1982, we have Megaforce, programmed by Doug Neubauer. Now, this particular game is one of those examples of a really, really lousy movie that was made into a pretty cool game. Now, the object of this game is that you are a member of Megaforce, which is kind of like a world police kind of thing. And your mission is to destroy the enemy headquarters outside of this fictional country called Serdan, and you are basically fighting against these evil people on a thing called the Moto Fighter, which is a motorcycle that can fly, and you pass the city and make your way across the barren desert to the enemy headquarters on a limited supply of fuel.
You'll be challenged the entire way by heavy air and ground attack. Should you travel too far into the barren desert, flashing arrows will direct you back toward the enemy. That's the only help you can expect. Really a fun game. I did not play this game until, not real recently, but within about the last like 5 years or so. And I have to tell you, it's a lot of fun, but one of the problems I have with this game is kind of the problem I have with a lot of games. I have kind of an itchy trigger finger, and I like to shoot everything. So a couple times I've shot the city and I wasn't supposed to. But anyway, like I said, a great game that was based on a really, really bad film.
I've never seen it. What was it like?
A very cheesy action film of the 80s.
Oh, that says it all.
Next up, we have Earth Dies Screaming from 1983, programmed by Dan Thompson. Now, in this game, the Earth is being attacked by these evil aliens called the Trillians, and they have set up attack bases which launch kamikaze satellites and Trillian fighters, and you've got to stop them. Now, this game reminds me a lot of Star Master and Star Raiders, and what probably is what the game adaption of The Last Starfighter may have turned out to be.
How come they didn't end up making that?
Well, yeah, that's a good question. Actually, they did, but most people believe that it was called Solaris.
You mean Solaris was originally supposed to be a tie-in to Last Starfighter?
Yep, it sure was.
That would have been kind of cool.
Well, the game itself was kind of cool, Solaris, I mean. But yeah, had the movie been a big box office success, they probably would have made a tie-in for it.
And our final game for today is The Entity, programmed by Mark Klein and would have been released in 1983, but it is actually a prototype.
Now, why would they make a video game of that movie? Well, yeah, that is a good question. As actually, The Entity was a pretty rough movie. It was actually about this woman who was being attacked, and that's one way of putting it, by this ghost or demon. It was actually supposed to be based on a true story.
Now, thankfully, the game isn't anything like that. In fact, it's actually very different. In this game, you are actually trying to move the entity up to the highest level. Now, in order to do that, you have to trap it and make it move up each level. And you have these two beams on each side, or walls of some kind, and you're trying to get the entity to be trapped so that it can move up through that hole. The problem is that the entity doesn't cooperate, and if it starts to get red and it feels trapped, it'll fight back. Now, in order to calm it down, you can press the button which shoots helium at it, which does kind of calm it down a little. But remember, you only have so much energy in order to battle the entity with. So, oh, see right there. I got it kind of squished between the walls and I lost energy, so. I have to say, this is probably one of the most interesting and unique games I've probably ever played. Definitely not a real big fan of the movie by any stretch of the imagination. And to be honest, it's about the only thing that this game has in common with the film itself is just the title.
Okay, so how come this wasn't released?
Well, again, the crumbling game market, and also for the fact that, honestly, I don't really think anybody would want to play a game based on that film, no matter how good the game was.
And the answer to today's trivia question, what is the name of the film that the unknown 20th century prototype was actually a tie-in to? And the answer is
Heart Like a Wheel, based on the 1983 biographical film about Shirley Muldani, the famous female drag racer. Many people, myself included, assumed that this was a tie-in to the film Six Pack starring Kenny Rogers, because it was actually advertised in a 20th Century Fox game catalog. However, it turns out that it was actually based on Heart Like a Wheel.
Well, that brings us to the end of another exciting episode of Classic Gamer 74. I really hope you all enjoyed it. I sure did. I'm glad, Mumford. That's very kind of you, seeing as you were part of it. I was? Yeah, we just did the whole episode. Oh, I thought I was dreaming. Anyway, if you enjoyed today's episode, don't forget to give us a great big thumbs up. Subscribe if you haven't already. Don't forget to click that little bell icon down there so you'll be notified when we upload new episodes. And please, consider helping this channel out on Patreon. For as little as a dollar a month, I remember back when a dollar a month was a lot of money. For as little as a dollar a month, you can help this channel to grow. So please, be generous and help us out on Patreon. The link is in the description below. I don't think there was ever a time when a dollar a month was a lot of money. No, maybe it was a dollar a day. Yeah, that's a little more realistic.
In our next episode, we will be discussing Atari 2600 prototypes, episode 5. And this will be our final episode discussing the Atari 2600 prototypes, as we will be moving on to other game systems.
You mean other game systems had prototypes?
Oh yeah, quite a few actually. And believe it or not, there actually are some arcade prototypes.
No way.
Oh, yes way. So you will not want to miss this next episode.
Well, until next time, I'm Anthony Gamer. Oh, I'm Mumford, and we will see each and every one of you in the next episode. Until then, have yourselves a great day. Goodbye.
Goodbye, everyone.